So now I'm going to talk about a different way of reducing dimensionality, which is not by selecting features, but by transforming the data, which is feature extraction. And we're going to look at one very widely used method of reducing dimensionality, which is principal component analysis. And also we're going to look at self-organizing maps, which is a kind of neural network that we can use to project data into two dimensions. And finally, I'm going to give an example of this idea of feature extraction from less structured data, and then dimension reduction with a self-organizing map. So the basic idea of feature extraction is either to reduce dimensionality by creating new features, aggregating data from the old features, or even creating features from unstructured data. Usually with structured data, which is what we saw so far, we have vectors of some fixed length with some fixed attributes that characterize each data point. But often data doesn't come like that. So if you have images, for example, images have different sizes, different shapes, different numbers of colors and things like that. Or if you have sound, you don't have these fixed vectors with specific features. So you may have some particular methods for extracting features from that data. For example, one method used for text documents is the bag of words extraction, in which you choose a set of words, or you identify which words appear on the document, and then you characterize each document with a very large vector by counting each type of word. So most of the words will be at zero, some of the words will have one, two occurrences, and so on. And that way, you transform text documents into fixed vectors of features, each element of the vector representing a count of one word. Then you can compress that with some dimensionality reduction or something like that, but you need this first step of creating structured features from the unstructured data. So that is one problem in feature extraction, which is very dependent on the actual data you're working with, so we're not going to look at that in detail. We're going to look at one very used transformation in which you take a higher dimension space and compress it into a lower dimension space by retaining as much variance as possible. So this is principal component analysis, and we're going to see how to do that. So the main idea is to find an orthogonal base. Imagine that you have your features in n dimensions, but you want to have a set of mutually perpendicular vectors that span the most variation of your data. So the first vector will point to where the data is spread the most, the second one in a perpendicular direction where most of the remaining variation is left, and then the third vector perpendicular to the first two, and so on. So this, we can do that by doing this principal component analysis. We can find all of these vectors in all of the dimensions, and then keep only a subset of them that represents most of the variance. So we're going to look at this toy example. We have this simple data set which is three-dimensional and which is spread out in this diagonal. So there is one direction in which the data is more spread out than the other direction. However, this is not aligned with any of the coordinates, it's this diagonal here. And what we want to do is to find this diagonal, and that would be our first feature, would be the position along that vector. The second feature would be a position along a perpendicular vector that would have most of the remaining spread of the point. And that way we could reduce these three-dimensional data to a two-dimensional data while retaining as much as possible of the spread of the point. Which does not happen if you simply project into one coordinate, because now you lose a lot of these distances by squishing everything to X, Y, or Z. So to do that, you're not going to implement this, but this is just to give you an idea of what the computations are. We're going to first compute the scatter matrix. This is a matrix that represents the spread of our points. And to do that, we find the midpoint of our data set. So this is the average, the vector with the average values for all the features. We just sum all the vectors that we have and divide by the number of the vectors. and we have the mean points of our data set. And now we're going to center all our points relative to that mean point. So we are going to subtract this mean vector from each of our points, and we are going to compute this product. So this, I'm assuming this is a column vector and this is a row vector, the transpose. And if you multiply the two, you get a matrix that has the same number of dimensions on rows and columns, and these are the same number of dimensions of your original vector. And in each cell, you have the product of the feature values. So the feature 1 with feature 1, feature 1 with feature 2, and so on all these metrics. So we're going to do this for each vector, and we're going to sum everything on the matrix. So this is the scatter matrix, which is the sum of all these products of the features for each of our vectors after centering them on the mean. And now we're going to find the eigenvectors for this scatter matrix. This is an algebra concept. Basically, an eigenvector of a matrix is a vector that when you multiply it by the matrix, you get something that is in the same direction as the original vector, only changes by some scaling factor. So basically, the eigenvectors of the scatter matrix are the directions in this n-dimensional space where the matrix does not change the orientation of the vector, only stretches the vector. So this is what we're going to try to find. We're going to find these eigenvectors. We can do that with a numerical library. And we have as many eigenvectors as the original dimensions. And this would be perpendicular vectors that span the complete dimensional space of the original matrix. These lambda values here are the eigenvalues. These are the values by which these vectors are stretched by the matrix. So the larger these values, the larger the spread of our points along the direction of that eigenvector. So this is an example of how we can do this. We have a three-dimensional data set, this data set. We start with our scatter matrix as a matrix of zeros with 3 by 3 cells. And now we're going to do these products here, the dot products of the centered vectors, and add them to the scatter matrix. So this is the mean vector here. This is the loop of the scatter matrix after adding everything. And now we can compute the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors using this function from the linear algebra module in NumPy. So we get these eigenvalues, 183, 51, and 54, and these eigenvectors, which come in a matrix. Each vector is one column of this matrix. So we know that most of the dispersion of our data, most of the variance of our data, is along this direction defined by this first vector here, because this is the vector with the largest eigenvalue. And then what remains of the variance of the dispersion of our data is in this direction here of the last vector, because of these two, this one has the highest eigenvalue. So we know that if we take the first vector and the last vector and project everything into those two directions, we can reduce from three dimensions to two dimensions and still retain as much as possible of the dispersion of the data that we have. So this would be the three eigenvectors here. One of them, you see, is aligned with this dispersion. The other two are perpendicular. And now we can choose the first one and the last one. And we transform our data by multiplying by that set of vectors, and so we project everything to two dimensions. And this is the result that we have here. So the x-coordinate is the eigenvector with the largest eigenvalue, so the one that was along the spread here, so it would be this one here, see, along this largest variance of our data. And then the second one, the y direction there, is the last eigenvector, which has the second largest eigenvalue. So this is the projection that we can do to our data to reduce from three dimensions to two, losing as little as possible of the variance of our points that we can. So any other projection would squeeze the points more together and lose more of their dispersion. So this is one very used way of reducing dimensionality. Note that we are not looking at the class labels, or we don't know if this is the best way for classification or something like that. Sometimes simply preserving the variance is not useful. Maybe there are other directions that would be more useful for classification. But this is what the kind of thing we do with unsupervised learning. We're only looking at the structure of the data, so we are reducing the dimensionality and preserving as much of the variance as possible. So with scikit-learn, you don't actually need to do the calculation of the scatter matrix and things like that. That is just to explain the algorithm. With scikit-learn, you have this PCA class, and you can just say how many components you want. You fit it with the data, so this structure is similar to most of these classes in scikit-learn. You create the object and then you call the fit method to adjust whatever parameters. And then you have these components, but you can use the transform method to transform your original data into a projection using the best m directions that you specified here. So if you want to reduce from three dimensions to two, you specify two components there, you fit with your data, and then you transform your data and get the result. And these the components here are the vectors, the directions of the best vector. So another way of projecting data into lower dimensions is to use self-organizing maps. This is also unsupervised learning. It's a neural network, but we can use it without any labels or classification. And the idea is that we have a matrix of neurons, a two-dimensional matrix of neurons, and each neuron has as many weights, as many coefficients, as the dimension of our data. So if our data is three-dimensional, we have three weights for each neuron. If it's 10 dimensions, we have 10 weights for each neuron. So we can imagine that each neuron is actually representing one point in the dimensions of our original data. So the neurons are there in between, among our data points. But also, we have the neurons disposed in this two-dimensional matrix. So each neuron has neighboring neurons, and it knows the distance to all other neurons within this two-dimensional matrix. So this topology of the neurons. So basically, we have two distance measures here. Between the coefficients, the weight values of the neuron, and each data point, we can measure a distance in the dimension of our data set, because the neurons are floating around among our data points. But also, between neurons, we can measure the distance by considering the distance within this two-dimensional matrix. We know that this neuron is adjacent to that one, and is twice removed from the other one next, and so forth. So what we're doing in training is we start with some random numbers for our neurons, so we spread them out randomly among our data points. And now we train by presenting each data point many times. So we present all the data points one at a time, and then we repeat and repeat, and we do that thousands of times. And in training, we find, for each data point, we find the best matching unit, the neuron that is closest to our data point in the dimension of our data set, and we do that by measuring the distance between the weight of the neuron and the coordinate values, the feature values of our data point. This way we find the closest neuron. And now we adjust the weight of that neuron by moving it slightly towards the point. And we also drag all the neurons that are around that one in the matrix, in this two-dimensional matrix, in the same direction, towards that data point. So basically, you can imagine that this neuron matrix is like an elastic sheet, and we are pulling it towards the point by pulling the closest neurons to each point, and we are spreading the two-dimensional matrix of neurons around and within all our data points. So, to illustrate this is an image from Wikipedia. We have a cloud of points here. We choose one point. The closest neuron is this one. So we drag this neuron closer to the point, and all the neurons that are near it in the network, in this two-dimensional network, also get dragged here. When we repeat this a lot of times, this elastic sheet, which is the two-dimensional matrix of neurons, will get reshaped into the same shape as our data. So let's see an example of using this to project three-dimensional data into two dimensions. For three-dimensional data, I'm going to use colors. Colors have three dimensions, red, green, and blue, these values. And I'm going to create a set of colors with black, blue, dark blue, and so on. We have different combinations of red, green, and blue to create this color. I'm also going to use this Miniton module, which is a simple implementation of a self-organizing map, just for this illustration. And basically, the methods that we're going to use, we have this class, the initialization, we have this, the dimensions of the self-organizing map, the number of neurons in X and Y to create that two-dimensional matrix, and then we have the length of the input, which is the number of dimensions that we want, so how many coefficients, how many weights per neuron we're going to have. And then there are some parameters for the learning rate and for the neighborhood, but we're not going to mess with those. So this is to create the object. Then we're going to initialize the weight. Initialization is basically assigning to each neuron a set of coefficients taken at random from our data point. So each neuron will get assigned at random to a different data point. And then we're going to do the training. We select a number of iterations. Each iteration is a batch with all our training sets, and we do this several thousand times. The learning rate will decrease slowly along this process, so that neurons will spread out and then will slowly adjust to the shape of our data. So basically, we start with we create a figure just for plotting. We create the Miniton object here with 20 by 30 neurons. We have three red, green, and blue values, so the depth here, the length of the input is 3. We select this learning rate and sigma. This sigma is a parameter for determining how much each neuron will influence those around it initially. But it will tend to decrease until the whole thing converges. Now we initialize with our list of colors, so the colors that we created here. This is our data. And now we train 10,000 batches, so 10,000 cycles to all the colors to spread out the sum. And now basically this is just for the plot. We're going for each of the colors find the closest neuron, and we're going to draw the name of the color in that place of the matrix, so that we spread the colors in their places on the self-organizing map. And then we're going to use the weight of the neurons to represent as an image. This image allows us to represent a matrix with red, green, and blue as an image. And since the weights are just the red, green, and blue components, we can show the sum as an image. And this is the result. So this the colors are in three-dimensional space, but as we train the self-organizing map to spread towards this three-dimensional space, we stretch this membrane of the two-dimensional matrix to cover all these colors. But now we can represent this in the space of the two-dimensional matrix of the self-organizing map. So this would be one neuron here, another one, and we have 30 by 20 neurons in this matrix. And we can also find, for each of our colors, which of the neurons is closest to that red, green, and blue combination. And that is what we use to plot here the names of the colors. So basically, we use the three-dimensional space, and we squeeze it into a two-dimensional representation by stretching the membrane through all the clouds of values. And now we can represent all the colors here and where they are placed. So now I'm going to use this to show a bit more elaborate example of feature extraction and the self-organizing map as an example. So we have this in this gapminder site. We have there are lots of great visualization tools there too, if you want to take a look. But we have data on indicators of development indicators for many countries. So we're going to this come in one Excel sheet per indicator, and they have one row for each country and one column for the year the indicator refers to. And the indicators we're going to use here are the gross domestic product per capita, life expectancy, infant mortality, and employment rate for people over 15. So this, there are many other indicators, but I'm going to choose these four. And this is the look of the data. We have, for each indicator, we have some years here. We have the countries. Note that for some countries, we don't have data for some years, or sometimes for many years. So the number of data values that we have for each country varies a lot between the countries and also between the indicators. So this is basically unstructured data. We don't have a fixed vector of features for each country. We have lots of different data for different years, and we need first to extract some features from that. So this is the case of Portugal, for example. In green, it's life expectancy. We have, these are estimates below 1940 or something, they are estimated. Then we have these measured values here, and then we have projections for the future too. Then we have here infant mortality in red. We have gross domestic product here. We only have data for this experience. These are all normalized values so that we can fit them all in the same scale. And here we have employment rate data, just a small fraction there. So you see, we don't have a fixed number of points for this. And also, between different countries, this is for the United States, for example, we have different amounts of data points. So if you want to characterize each country by these indicators, we need to extract some features from these points and organize everything into a fixed number of values for the vectors. So some examples, United States, China, and so on. So what we're going to do is we're going to, for each indicator here, fit a third degree polynomial. A third degree polynomial has four different different parameters. And these four different parameters will now represent each of the indicators. So by doing this with the four indicators, we can have each country represented by a vector of 16 parameters, four for each of the indicators. So this is an example of feature extraction. We have unstructured data, but now we find a way of describing that data in a fixed number of parameters for each country. And now we can convert all the data for each country into these 16 dimensions. So this is an example of all the countries there in gray. These are the polynomials for Portugal, for the four indicators, for the United States, and so on. So we can do this for any country, and we have all the polynomial curves for all the countries. So now we have extracted these features from our unstructured data, and we have a 16-dimension data set. Each of our countries has these 16 values that characterize the four indicators. So now, how are we going to organize this and be able to look at how the countries are spread out? We can use the self-organizing map to adjust this map of neurons to this 16-dimensional space, and then represent everything in the two-dimensional space of the neuron matrix. So basically what we're going to do is to train the self-organizing map and then label a list of countries that you choose into that map. The idea is the same. We create the self-organizing map. We initialize the weights with our descriptors for the countries. So this is a 16-column matrix and with one row for each of the countries. Then we batch train everything and we read from this file which countries to plot. And we plot them by finding the closest neuron to each country. So basically, we're going to look at the countries. We find the winner, which is the neuron that is closer to the descriptors for each country. And then we plot the name of the country in the self-organizing map. We're also going to use this bone color map to indicate the distance between the neurons. So neurons that are close together will have a darker color. Neurons that are stretched farther apart in the dimension of our country will have a lighter color. And this is the result. You can see this is Qatar, which is a very strange country, very rich, but with a strange development, not like other countries, because it's mostly a very small country with lots of oil. And you see that these neurons are very stretched out because this one is an outlier, very far away from the others. Then you have Austria, United States, Germany, United Kingdom, Portugal here. Then you decide you have Kazakhstan, Cuba, Russia, Greece, and so on. And then you go all the way here, Madagascar, Brazil, and so forth. So different countries with different development profiles will get spread out differently in this two-dimensional map. So this is one way we can organize high-dimensional data into a low dimension that we can visualize. So self-organizing maps are good for this. And also, another important part of this example is this process of trying to extract structured features from data that is not very structured. So if we just fed this data into something, it would be hard to work with it because different countries have different number of data points and the points do not correspond to exactly the same thing and so forth. So we have two steps here. First, converting unstructured data into a fixed number of indicators, and then because we have this in 16 dimensions, we project everything into two dimensions where it's easier to visualize. So this is an example of what we can do with unsupervised learning, but next week we're going to start looking at clustering algorithms and so on, which is another type of application of supervised learning. So to sum up for this, note that so far we've always been using this nicely structured data. We have a table with a fixed number of columns and one example in each data in each row, but not all data is like this. If you want to classify emails, or if you want to classify images or something like that, you don't have everything neatly organized in a table. So you need first to extract features to do something with that data. We also saw principal component analysis and self-organizing maps as two examples of modifying or changing the data in order to project it into a lower dimensional space. So they work differently. In principal component analysis, we are trying to find the directions of maximum dispersion. With a self-organizing map, we are trying to project everything into two dimensions by stretching the array, the matrix of neurons to our data, to the shape of our data. So we saw this example of how we can deal with unstructured, messy data and try to make it behave and do what we want. There is a tutorial here for primary component analysis. You have some tools and some examples in scikit-learn in the documentation. And also, the self-organizing map algorithm is very simple. So basically, you just pull the neurons, but you can read the description with some illustrations on Wikipedia, for example.